afternoon, everyone. I'm Tammy Gubarek. I'm a PhD candidate at the School of Information. This will be my first CHI, so I'm really looking forward to all of your feedback and suggestions on how to better present our work in the community. I'm going to be talking about a collaborative project that I've been working on with various colleagues, Allison McDonald over at Computer Science and Engineering, and then here at SI, Sylvia Signoni, Abraham Dali, Carlo Yama, and Francia. So first, I want to begin by telling you about a woman, one of our participants, who I'll call Maria. Maria came to the United States 12 years ago seeking infertility treatment. And she's since been able to have two kids. She met up with her husband. They're doing pretty well. Their kids go to local schools. They participate in community programs. They regularly attend Sunday services at the local church. She goes to the gym. So we could say that Maria is just like any ordinary member of society, except for one important thing. Maria is undocumented, an undocumented immigrant in the United States. So what does that mean? Undocumented immigrants either cross the border or they overstayed a legal visa, and that's no longer valid, and therefore they don't have authorization to live and work in this country, and therefore are subject to detention and deportation at any time. So Maria tries to go about her day as normally as possible, but she does have a cloud of anxiety that weighs over her, and she makes some important adjustments to try to stay safe. So she avoids driving, which is an important one, because this could present unwanted contact with law enforcement. She sometimes avoids speaking Spanish in some places that she senses there could be hostility, like she felt was at a local pharmacy. And some of her neighbors have recently been raided by the Immigration and Customs Enforcement Agency, ICE. So she signed up to receive local alerts from community organizations on where ICE might be patrolling neighborhoods so she can avoid those areas and redirect her route. Like Maria, there are an estimated 11.3 million undocumented immigrants in the United States, according to estimates by Pew Research. And undocumented immigrants have been receiving increasing attention. There has an increased immigration enforcement over the past several years, and then increasingly over since the recent administration, immigration enforcement has been less targeted. Before, it was pretty common that ICE would prioritize people who had some kind of criminal record, and now detentions and deportations have been much more random. There have been many stories of families being ripped apart, as families are often of mixed status. So people have had U.S.-born children who have U.S. citizenship, or they have young children that came that until recently had a temporary status. We also know there's been a trend for increasing high surveillance of this population. There have been news of cell tower simulators that have been used to locate, using a phone number to locate individuals in a certain area and then proceed to detain them. There's been news about plans to monitor social media accounts and to ask immigrants coming into the United States for their social media handles. So we asked, in this context, we were very motivated to know, does the vigilance and the caution that we saw Maria taking in her offline world, does that carry over to the online world for undocumented immigrants? So more formally, these were our research questions. The first is, how do undocumented immigrants use technology in their daily lives? What risks do they perceive as they use technology? And then what are their protective strategies? So first we had a look at the literature, various literatures. And we looked at literature on immigration and integration by undocumented immigrants and found that this population faces tremendous challenges and tremendous difficulties to their well-being. But they also have various strategies and are quite resilient, and they avoid risks in many different ways, and I won't go into too much detail for this interview. We also looked at just a more broader literature on how immigrants use technology and know that technology is very important for integration into communities, into society. And then we looked at the vast and growing literature on privacy and security use and behavior. And there are many relevant points in that literature as far as tensions with networked privacy, paradoxes between privacy concerns of some populations and disconnects with their privacy behaviors, boundary turbulences as other people increasingly have control over information of others, and then various community-specific literatures that talk about concerns and practices of some specific communities. But we found there's very little known about how undocumented immigrants perceive and respond to privacy and security risks online. So how did we approach the research? First, we spent several months developing relationships with local immigrant support groups. And then they advertised among their networks to help us recruit. And we conducted 17 interviews with undocumented immigrants in person, semi-structured interviews, mostly in Spanish. Throughout our research, we kept very strict data protection practices, and we really tried to avoid asking people for identifying information. And then we come to the interviews and analyze them for privacy. So just some quick demographics about our participants. All of them are from Latin America. Most of them are from Mexico. There was a wide range of ages, but the average age was 35. All of them have been in the United States for 10 years or longer, so they're a more settled population in the United States rather than immigrants that have more recently arrived. And most of them have mixed status families, meaning that there are various different legal statuses among members of the family. And then, only two of our participants were men, most of them were women, and this was mostly due to people being home during the day, so we had a hard time recruiting and getting men to be available for our interviews. So now I'll proceed to talking about our findings on our participants' technology use, concerns, and practices. So we found that technology is essential, is very important in the daily lives of our participants. It's especially to keep in touch with family and friends back home. They now can do that, you know, without cost to them, without having to pay high calling cards to talk with families back home, to be able to have a richer engagement with grandparents, for example. But also to participate in their local communities here. They use it to communicate with their kids' school, to stay up on the news, etc. We found that they use a pretty limited set of tools, of technologies and tools, primarily Facebook. All but one of our participants were very active on Facebook. They use various messaging platforms, but primarily WhatsApp. So there were a small set of tools that they used, but they're really important for them. With respect to concerns, many of the concerns that they mentioned were pretty similar to what you would hear a general population being concerned about. So they most often talk about identity theft, keeping their kids away from inappropriate content or strangers online. They talked about trying to keep their networks small and close-knit, avoiding unwanted visibility. So they would only accept requests from family and friends into their social media networks. And then we heard some of our participants talk about some sensitive content. So some talked about not posting photos of their children on their social media, doing that more in bilateral direct messaging apps. Some talked about not posting their location on Facebook specifically, although they didn't link these concerns specifically to their legal status. And then specifically related to their legal status, they did talk about avoiding very clear public spaces online. So, like the comment sections on news websites to avoid hateful remarks. Then we heard our participants wondering about whether they should be concerned about certain things. So, for example, there was a recent raid at a local restaurant, and one of our participants wondered, what if the police looks at the contacts and group lists on that young man's phone, who was detained? Could that put any of the members of our community at risk? Another person wondered, well, I attended this event last week. Should I worry that my picture was taken? And then another concern that we heard is people who use WhatsApp in groups were, one person specifically said, you know, why can I see the phone numbers and the names of some people who are not in my contact list? And here's just an image of my own, a group I've recently been added to in WhatsApp, and I've blurred out, but I had access to the phone numbers and the names of a lot of people who weren't my, who aren't in my group because I was put into a group with them. So literally, increasingly, people's information and the security of their information is in other people's hands. Then our participants talked about various notions of surveillance. So about half of them talked about surveillance in a very general, kind of abstract way, where they would mention fear of being traced or concern that others who they were not authorized could see, have access to their information. One person said, my Facebook could be private, but the government could probably see it. They, moving ahead, they could probably see anything on my phone that they want to. So this kind of general sense that, just going back, so about half of them talked specifically about government surveillance, and this idea that the government has is omnipresent and all-powerful, and they could probably have access to any information that they wanted to. And just to put this a little bit in context, we found that our participants had, to varying degrees, had contact with public institutions and have shared information about themselves to public institutions. So, many of our participants' kids go to public schools where they have to share their addresses and their names. Many of them pay taxes regularly. Some of them have signed up to receive food stamps as assistance to their children who are eligible who are born in the United States. And some people talked about this tension between participating actively and expressing themselves on their social media pages. So in one case, a woman was talking about this tension with her mother. Her mother said, maybe you shouldn't post your opinion about the US president on your Facebook page, because if you ever are going to have a chance at getting immigration papers, they're not going to like that you're critiquing their president. And she responded, listen, I'll share my thoughts before I get any papers. And so this is kind of emblematic of a tension that some families are navigating between self-expression on these platforms that they're trying to curate to stay safe, and maybe considering self-censoring. Interestingly, Facebook is the main communication platform for most of our participants. We found that there was a tremendous level of trust in Facebook and the other tools that they were using. A couple people mentioned this idea that when there had been attempts to log in with their information, that Facebook had specifically sent them an alert and asked them to quickly change their password. And so that gave them a sense that overall, Facebook had their best interests, was taking care of their interests, and that generally they should trust Facebook. They didn't have a sense of Facebook or any of the platforms as having any interest in the data or access to the data, nor much less that a company such as Facebook would have to respond to a legal request to share information if it was if it came from a legal subpoena, for example, that they would have to abide by that request. So we found that our participants did have some, yet very limited precautions. So as mentioned, some took care to not post pictures, to not post their location, and avoided very clearly public spaces online. What we didn't hear any of our participants talk about was using the privacy settings and tools available on their smartphone or on various tools that they were using. So, while there are some concerns, overall we found that Maria, and many other people in the community are actually living their online lives much like anybody else. Despite concerns, they are not taking very many steps to mitigate them. And we found that this was in stark contrast to this more thoughtful approach to assessing and mitigating risks offline, where you know people are making some important decisions about sometimes not letting their kids stay home by themselves, finding what are the safe spaces and really participating only there, and some specific decisions about avoiding law enforcement. And what this often meant is that some people are foregoing their cars, but they're not foregoing their phones. So we were left with the question of why. You know, with all of these findings, why is it that a population with objectively higher risks is not taking very many steps to protect their privacy, to protect themselves as they use their technology? There was a recent study that found that Hispanic adults have generally low levels of digital literacy. But we felt that this was an insufficient explanation for what we were seeing, based on the literature and based on our findings. So we posed these additional factors. So one, the benefits that this community, that our participants are receiving from technology, far outweigh the perceived risks, the risks that they believe that they're more conscious about. But overall, digital risks are mostly unknown to them, or are uncertain how some disclosure of information could lead to some concrete consequences. We found that trust is pretty powerful, that the platforms that they're using are not the government, they don't see them as the government, and they mostly trust them. And they also trust their peers. They see, most people in the community that we spoke to were using the same set of tools, and they weren't seeing that anybody was making, had any kind of horror stories of extreme consequences or anything that would lead them to believe that they should change the tools that they were using or the way they were using them. And then finally, we got a sense of this overall resignation to that. If the government really wanted to know something about them, it was unlikely that they could do something within their control to mitigate that. So what can we learn from this? We find that it's really important to invest in very conscientious technology design. What this doesn't mean is building new tools, oftentimes, as at least our participants were probably unlikely to adopt very new digital security tools. We're using a fairly limited set of tools, and installing a new tool is unlikely and probably would make them stand out more than blend in. So what we do find is a need to protect them in the tools that they're using, specifically add protections for unwanted visibility. And this could mean making audiences, various audiences, whether it's the audience they intend to be sharing information with, or broader audiences, the platforms themselves as potential party that can access their information, or third parties. To be much more transparent of who has access to any information or content that they post online. Also the need to limit exposure of identifying information. And so this is specifically important for privacy in groups. As we see, minor design decisions such as making a piece of information like a phone number that can be seem pretty innocuous can be relatively sensitive for this community. So we believe there's room for additional research on how to improve the ability for people to manage their privacy in group and community settings. And then more broadly, there's a sense that it's important to be aware and mindful that mitigating risk rests with all of us. All of us increasingly hold information about other people, and potentially some things could be sensitive for communities such as this one. And finally, we found room for improved educational resources. So we didn't find educational resources easily accessible in Spanish, But beyond that, and beyond kind of security tools, we find there's a need to, it would be helpful to help this community be more aware of how information flows and how they can make decisions about what they want to disclose or not disclose more confidently. And we've been working on providing some workshops in Spanish with a local organization. So in sum, offline, undocumented immigrants avoid risks, but online, they struggle to understand and to mitigate risks. Various factors that I talked about make managing their privacy difficult. And we find a need to improve the usability and the transparency of privacy and security for companies to invest in this to protect the users that are entrusting them with their data. And finally, just the sense that all of us have a role to play in creating a safer digital world for this community and communities at large. So should we do questions straight away, or I don't know how what the format is, but yeah, that would be great. I didn't know it was by a question up with Janet.
Oh, I guess my comment was more feedback, so if there's questions, we should do that
first. This is really great. Thank you very much. I was curious if you found anything about the role that children play in this environment, that is, children using technology and parents wanting to be with them in that technology or communicate, if anything came up about that, as a driver for, getting deeper into the technology.
No, absolutely. No, thank you for that question. Possibly because most of our participants were parents and many of them mothers, the question of children was probably, in addition to the question of identity theft, how to protect children online and kind of concerns around the use of their kids, the kids' use of technology was a main theme. When we were asking our participants about what they would want to see in privacy and security workshops, they really called for an emphasis on how to help them protect their kids online more than they do. And the sense that that their kids are more savvy with technology than they are. And so that also is part, I think, of the motivation for wanting to learn. The real strong sense of kind of being able to enhance their digital literacy and their privacy, but also, just being more comfortable with technology. Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you.
I think you did a lovely job in a very natural speaking style, so it was very engaging. So I think you're in great shape. My only two comments were, so for instance, with this particular slide, where I think you really do want to kind of end with, on a strong note, I guess I could probably look at each of these points and say these are true for just a general population. So I wonder if it might be useful to think through a little bit about what specifically the population that you study, like what's different about them and maybe kind of try to drive that in here a little bit.
Yeah.
And then the only other thought I had is that there's some work on network privacy by Alex Marwick and a whole bunch of folks, and a few of the insights that you made here around this idea that we need to think about the information sharing about other people and the piece about the kind of perceived vulnerability about other people sharing information about your participants. I think maybe you could, it might be useful to kind of hook into that literature because that is something that's fairly well established. So again, kind of what's different.
Right. No, that's a great point. I mean, we definitely do that in the paper, but I should definitely bring that out more.
Great paper, great summary. And I share the humanitarian concern of vulnerable populations, particularly those that are close by. Well, I wondered whether you dealt at all in your study about the legal ethical issues. So there are U.S. laws that make it a crime to harbor an immigrant. And And so where does that line extend to providing software or tools as opposed to an educational role, which may be more general? It may be a fuzzy line that you may want to get some input from like the School of Law here.
Right, I mean, I think what I've seen is that that companies such as Facebook do have to abide by the law. I mean, if they do get a legal request for some information, if somebody is being investigated, then they do have to comply. And actually, in that case that I mentioned about the cell site simulator, the way that that I got access to the phone number was through a request to Facebook. So I think and this actually came up in Mark Zuckerberg's testimony, is that he isn't proactively offering information, but he does have to comply if it comes with a legal request. But we still think that despite the physical borders, these companies can take on a position of protecting their users wherever they may be. And some of the things that we think could make privacy more usable can apply to any user, to any community, not just this one.
Yeah, insofar as it's a general capability, then you like Facebook is saying, if they're a general platform used for many things, the fact that it's used for communication among illegal immigrants is not something that they can necessarily be liable for. If, however, you take these concepts and say, we really want to have a new app that has some of these features built in that protect specifically immigrant populations, then you may have a legal issue that you need to be fully aware of.
So I was thinking about something that was very interesting about this dissonance between being very careful with physical environment versus not being very careful in the online environment. And I'm wondering whether you framed this in some sense of inattention, which is either do you think that's willful inattention, or is it just I'm kind of trying to remember what's the there's a concept where it's like this ostrich effect where you know something bad, and so like when the share markets are going downwards, you don't look at your portfolio because you're expecting bad news. So you know that you're being tracked, but you just say I'm just gonna tell us.
So you're wondering if you think that maybe that's what's behind the lack of protective behavior online.
Right. So it's this kind of motivated inattention. Like, do you know that this might be bad for you, but you're not doing it, or do you just not know? I mean, which do you?
Yeah. I mean, I think there probably is a mix. I think that there are some of our participants prefer not to be worrying about like everything all the time. And they'd rather, kind of focus on living their lives as normally as possible and, just thinking. They are very, they were very aware that there were risks, and, some of them went to greater extents to mitigate them than others. Others just kind of felt like, I'll just, go about my business as normally as I can, and hopefully, I won't have any trouble. And so I think some of that can also be extending to the online world, not overly, being concerned and paranoid
So that's actually a good point to actually slip in somewhere, is that it's not a natural way of being to be constantly worrying about your state. And this, were we making people more, what are we doing if we are making people more paranoid?
Yeah, I think we actually do talk about it a little bit in the paper, in that, being constantly worried is really harmful to your general overall well-being.
Sure.
And so some ways that people mentioned it is, but a deal with it is by not worrying, of trying to avoid. So that's a good point. I think I definitely make that up. Yeah.
presumably this topic, I don't know exactly, but my thought is probably it might be difficult to get contact with those people at a distance and then generate some information about how this is very practical language.
So
for the 17 interviews, did you have some follow-up?
No, thank you for the question. I think our approach was we was first to establish a relationship with the organizations that undocumented women already have a strong connection with, that they already trust, and that are thinking very, very carefully about how to protect the population that they work with. I think they believe, you know, we established that we had aligned interests and that we were interested in figuring out, you know, what are the challenges in protecting yourself online. And so after speaking with many organizations, I think we spoke with 7, and then with one specific one that really helped us do the recruiting, we met with them, many people at the organization. They felt comfortable, you know, recruiting among their population for us. And it was a general call. We didn't get that many people who called. You know, our sample is pretty small. And then from there, we tried to, you know, we were very careful to create an environment that the participants felt comfortable with. Almost all the interviews were done at a location that they felt comfortable with, often in their homes. So, you know, once they let us into their home, you know, there was, I think, already kind of an established sense that, you know, they were going to speak to us, and that they felt comfortable, you know, sharing with us. We set up the interview protocol also to be kind of broad and, you know, just ask about their technology use in general, ask about their concerns, methods in general, to really let things kind of emerge as they felt them, and then only at the end we have some very specific follow-up questions. So we spent anywhere between an hour to maybe even 2 hours in some of the interviews, and that was the way that the question went. But it was only, we did have some follow-up contact with them, but it was mostly when people were interested in helping us connect with another member of the community. So we did do some snowballing, and through that we had additional contact, but not a second round of interviewing. Thank you.